Thank you very much. Then, essentially, I'm going to give you an overview of clinical research, what we call from idea to publication, and this is the outline of my presentation. I'm going to address a little bit first of the definitions and study design, going to planning, analyzing the study, disseminating study findings, and then, as was already alluded, a little bit of our clinical research infrastructure that we have in the Division of Infectious Diseases. Regarding definition of research, then we are going to, in biomedical research, we generate new knowledge doing research, and the ultimate goal for us is always to improve patient care. Then we can say that this creation of new knowledge to improve patient care, while we are doing evidence-based medicine or evidence-based practice, with the idea to do patient care using the best research evidence. I was just walking toward the ground rounds, and I noticed all these figures that creating knowledge to improve patient care that we have around the hospital. This is what we do at the university. We create new knowledge with the idea to improve patient care. And the evidence, as you know, in the literature, there are different ways to look at the evidence, but mostly you see this pyramid of evidence where we have considered high-quality evidence, the prospective, randomized, double-blind clinical trial, and then moving, and this will be all the research, for instance, laboratory research, moving to animal research, going into research using human subjects that would be defined as clinical research. And what I'm discussing today, clinical research, we have either interventional studies or we have the possibility of observational studies. Then interventional studies are usually higher in the pyramid of evidence. Then essentially when we go now to make rounds and see patients and try to do the best for the patient, we're always looking at this. We're looking what is the best evidence in research. And there are different ways to evaluate the evidence. Now we have the GRACE system, probably the most accepted. But going back to research, then I mentioned that clinical research is the generation of new knowledge when we are doing studies with patients. And then what are the clinical studies or the designs of the clinical studies? Then the interventional studies, as you know, intervention is where the investigator is going to do something to a patient. It's going to be an intervention. Then we're going to give a drug, we're going to give a questionnaire, we're going to do something to the patient, and then we're going to have the classical one, the randomized clinical trial. Then we have non-randomized clinical trials, which is also quasi-experimental studies, or sometimes the pre-post intervention studies. All these are going to be interventional studies. Then we have the observational studies, from the single case report, case series, all the way to the cohort studies. I'm going to go to the different designs, but we know that a cohort study is the one that you select a large group of patients and you follow the patients over time. As always, these observational studies, for instance, may be retrospective, may be prospective, and I want to emphasize here that when we do patient care and we look at the best evidence, even though the best evidence is coming for prospective randomized double-blind clinical trials, most of what we do with our patients is based on observational studies, because 70 to 80% of what we know in medicine is based on observational studies. Yesterday I opened the Annals of Internal Medicine that arrived home, and because I was giving this presentation, I said, let me go through the Annals and figure out what type of designs do they have there. There was not a single interventional studies. They were all observational studies and meta-analysis and systematic reviews. Then I want to, even though the best evidence is clinical trials, prospective clinical trials, this is 30% of research, of clinical research. Most of the clinical research is observational studies. And for anyone that is going to start doing clinical research, at the beginning will always be observational studies. Now, this is the best evidence, But the problem is these are the most expensive studies, and these are you need to have very well funded, and this is why these are more difficult to do. Most of the things that you are going to be reading are going to be coming from cohort studies. Okay, if I want to simplify everything that happened in clinical research just in four steps. It doesn't matter if it's going to be a clinical trial or it's going to be a cohort study, four steps, all clinical research. And this will be the fourth step. We always start with planning the study, then we move to performing the study, then we move to analyzing the data, and then we're going to disseminate the results. Because really the definition of clinical research is the creation and dissemination of new knowledge using subjects. Then we need to create new knowledge, the first three steps. We need to disseminate the knowledge, the last step. Then in planning the study, you go from idea, this is the research question, these are the subtopics. You end up with a study protocol. If I want to say performing the study, you do patient enrollment, you do data collection, you end up with your study database. Analyzing the data, you look at the statistical analysis, clinical analysis, you end up with your conclusion of your study. And then when you try to disseminate, there are different ways to disseminate research. You can write abstract posters that you end up, but you're going to end up with a peer review publication. And this will be the 5-minute summary of clinical research. Now, let me go for a little more detail just to get another 40 minutes of the presentation. Then the planning and performing of the study, going with a little more detail. In when we look at clinical research, you need to look at the patients in the universe. When you read it, the patients in the universe is all the patients globally that you want to improve practice. This is the difference between clinical practice and clinical research. When we go on now main rounds, we improve the care of one patient at a time. When we're doing clinical research and we have a question, it's for the questions of the patients in the universe. Then if you are dealing with diabetes or pneumonia or renal disease, you are interested in a question that applies to everybody with renal disease all over the world. These are the patients in the universe. You notice that there is a lack of knowledge by reading the literature, by going to meetings, and you come out with your research question. I always mention in clinical research, coming with a research question is not a problem. You go make rounds today, you're going to come out with 20 important questions. Then what is the problem? The problem is, what is going to be the question that based on what I have available, I'm going to be able to answer? Then the challenge is you need to match the most important questions that you can get with the possibilities that you have to answer the question. Then we come up with a research question, and after the research question, then is the time to write this 1 or 2 pages study outline, or the letter of intent, or these are different names, but you were to go all the way to an NIH proposal, maybe your aims, but it's always 1 page to 2 pages that you have to tell the story. And this is going to be essentially these 1 or 2 pages as you have this idea. And then what you're going to write in these 2 pages, it's almost like it's a mini protocol. Now, in these 2 pages, you're going to say what is your rationale. I mean, you've been reading the literature, why is the study necessary, what is the objective of the study, or what is the question that you're going to address. The study may or may not have a hypothesis. I will discuss it. The study is an observational study. We spent 2 years collecting every pneumonia patient in Louisville to define the incidence of pneumonia per 100,000 population to estimate the incidence of pneumonia in the United States. There is no hypothesis. We are just counting the number of pneumonia patients every day in Louisville. Now, you're going to have a predictor variable, the outcome variable, you think that this is associated with that, then you're going to have a hypothesis. But then you're going to see what subjects, who are the subjects, how many, the variables, the predictor variable, the outcome variables, and then the statistical issues. These 1 or 2 pages is something that you're going to start moving around with your colleagues, with your other investigators, and they are going to tell you, yes, do this, change. And you're still you're not even doing the study. You're still trying to figure out if this study is valid. This idea that I have this great question, do you think that it's a valid question? you need to put things into one or two pages, and then people are going to let you know if this is good to continue or not. Let's say that everybody said, this is a great idea, these two pages looks great, let's move ahead, let's do this. Then we're going to start writing the study documents. We're still in the planning of the study. And the study documents, I always say that we need to address four questions. What do you plan to do? And what you plan to do is essentially the study protocol. Step by step, everything that you're going to do in your clinical study. How you're going to do it is the study manual, the standard operating procedures. I mean, one thing is a protocol. I want to enroll patients with fever. The other thing is how you're going to measure the fever, what thermometer you're going to use, the procedures of how you're going to do the study. How much is it going to cost? Every study has a cost. It's interesting because we discuss this study is funded, this study is unfunded. Well, from the outside. But every study has a cost. Even when a resident is doing the case report, I mean, someone is putting time, someone is putting energy, there's always a cost. The question is, who is going to pay? Now, sometimes when we pay, because we do the unfunded studies, we call this study is unfunded, but someone is always paying. Then you have to have a study budget. And another thing that everything that we're going to do in research, we need to know if we are going to be able to do it. This is, you need to ask permission to do any form of research. Then you need to have ethical and regulatory documents. I remember, some of us remember the years that a case report was just a case report. Let me write the case report, let me send it. Because a case report was just a case report. A case report is research. A case report is one piece of the observational studies. A case report, you need to go to the IRB, you need to have permission. Because everything that you do in research, someone will have to give you permission. Besides these study documents, there are other two important elements, that is the data collection form and the database that you're going to use for your study. And we always discuss, when you start developing the data collection form, you start already developing the database, because the data collection form needs to match the database. And at this moment, probably REDCap, this database developed by Vanderbilt University for a grant from the NIH, is becoming the standard database that in all universities. At this moment, there are more than 300 universities using REDCap, and probably this is going to be, and I understand even in some requests for application from the NIH, now they are requesting that you're going to use REDCap as your database. Then we are moving to every one of our databases now is REDCap. This is going to be probably the standard moving forward. All this is in the planning of the study. A lot of work to do in the planning of the study. Then we finish with the planning. Everything is approved. Your protocol is approved. You have your database. And now we are going to be moving to performing the study. And performing the study, simplistically, we can say, well, we are going to, if it's a prospective study, we are going to find the patients, enroll the patients. You may or may not need to get consent following patients. You do the data entry. And then everything is going into the database. In this process of doing the study, there's a critical aspect, that is the aspect of data quality, to be sure that your data is solid. And then after some period of time, we are going to say, okay, we have enough of quality, and we are going to log the database, and we are going to finish this idea of performing the study. Now I have to tell you then essentially, once you log the database, you already have the three type of patients that we always discuss in clinical research. As you mentioned, we deal with pneumonia, and if we want to see if this antibiotic is going to decrease mortality or pneumonia, we want to see if this antibiotic decrease mortality in the patients in the universe. We want to say if this antibiotic decrease mortality, we want these antibiotics to be used in every country, all over the world, in every patient with pneumonia. Now, then we study the patients in the universe with a sample that are the 500 patients that I have in my study protocol. At the end of the day, the only patient that I have are the ones that are in the study database. So instead of 500, it's always going to be less. Let's say it's 300. Then we have three types of patients. The patients in the universe, the patients that I wanted to study in the protocol, that is simple because I write the protocol having coffee, and then the patient in the database that is performing the study, going to the hospital, doing this, and then I always lost patients. This is the patients in the study database. Then I finish planning and performing the study. Until now, until we finish with the locking the database, this is a prospective cohort study that I want to do of the next 300 patients with diabetes that you're going to see in the clinic, and you have your question, and you plan the study, you have everything approved for the IRB, everything is in order, you perform the study, you log the study database. For every study is different, but it's going to be very unlikely that this is going to be less than 1 year. This is going to be between 1 or 2 years for every study. Then this is why sometimes it's interesting to me when a fellow that's going to be 2 years, a fellowship in some place, or even a resident, is going to say, oh, just take 6 months, 1 year to figure out what idea do you have. Then you're going to write the protocol. Then you're going to collect the patient. And I was thinking, by the time that you finish with the database, you are gone. You're already in a different university, unless you want to do resident here, fellowship here, and then remain here as a faculty. This is a long time. Now, what are the alternatives that we have? Well, if we were to know that at this moment someone in GI is doing a prospective study enrolling patients with liver disease, and you know that this is going on already and they are collecting patients, well, one possibility is to do an ancillary study. I know the data collection form, I know the database, I approach the group that is doing this, I say, well, you know what, I would like to ask this different question to your study. And then you add a new question. We are doing a pneumonia study, and we are collecting all the patients, and someone said, well, you know, I'm interested to see this, all these problems with influenza. I'm interested to see how well the influenza vaccine worked this year. Can we ask a question, do you receive influenza vaccine? Well, we're already spending the money and the effort. Then you just blend with an ancillary study. Then this would be one way to for a person to do speed and economy. Even more economy and even better is if you arrive to a place and you say, well, these are the different databases that we have in this university. This is a database of patients with cardiological problems, that this is the issue. This is a database from patients with pneumonia, there is the data, and then you know the databases, and you learn about the database. This is what they collected. And essentially, you come out with a research question to the database. This is what's called secondary data analysis. Then, and I mean, this is why I say, this is what a resident is supposed to be doing, or even a fellow. The data is already collected, the data quality is already there, the database was already done. This, and I have to tell you that anyone that has a database with thousands of patients, everybody recognizes that there is not enough time to publish. There's not enough time to get all the publications from a large database. There's always something new, there's always a new question to the database. Then this will be secondary data analysis. We publish a lot in the division of secondary data analysis of all the databases that we have. Then yesterday was estimating that in 2017, from all the members of the division, we have close to 57 publications. Now, are these 57 publications because we perform 57 prospects? No. There were 5, 6, 7 publications of the original publication, and the rest is these large databases that we keep asking questions. Okay, then you have your question, you have your data, either because you went through the full painful 2 years to collect all the data, or you just went to someone that had the data. The data is there. Now, this is your question. Now you're going to do the analysis or the study results based on your question. Then we are here in the analysis. Then you have the study database, you have the study results. And this antibiotic decrease mortality. Or this, or as we looked the other day, someone said, well, we have all these controversy of obesity and infection, because it seems to be that obesity is a protected factor for infection. Then we're looking at, are obese patients has better outcomes with pneumonia? This is in the database. We are just, it's a secondary data analysis. Then we, let's say that we find obese patients has decreased mortality. We need to come out with these study results. And again, I'm not interested to see if the obese patients in Louisville have decreased mortality. I want to say that every obese patient in the universe is going to have decreased mortality if they have pneumonia, because this is the goal. You are doing research for the patients in the universe. Then you have to infer from your results to what happened in the universe. Then, from the patients in the universe, we get the sample, we get the database, we get an answer. Now, as always, the answer that I got from, let's say, from Louisville, obesity is associated with decreased mortality. Well, I get an answer. The database always gives you an answer. Now, the answer may be the right answer or the wrong answer. No, this is, now we're starting the analysis. This is always the case. Is the association cause-effect? Obesity is associated with decreased mortality. Well, if this is the case, I got the right answer. I get the truth in the universe. The other options is that obesity associated with decreased mortality is the wrong answer. And maybe the wrong answer because of confounder, bias, or chance. Then this is where we start, when you start doing the data analysis, always the same process, the same type of questions. If this is the truth, then the predictor variable is causing the outcome variable, the truth in your data. Maybe confounding, because the association, that the problem with confounding, that is, again, this is so confusing, confounding, because the association that you find is real. The predictor variable is always associated with the outcome variable, but the association is not cause-effect. Everybody that opened it, a book of research is always the same example. Not predictor variable, coffee, outcome variable, lung cancer, confounder variable, smoking. Because really, the person that drink too much coffee always smoke, and then the smoking is the cause of lung cancer. Well, but the question is, then, is coffee associated with lung cancer? The answer is yes. You can repeat the study in every place, and the people that drink a lot of coffee are going to have lung cancer. This is the problem of confounder. Looks very real because you keep doing, and you keep finding the same results. But the problem is that coffee is associated with lung cancer, but it's not the cause of lung cancer. Then in confounder, the association is real. The problem is not cause-effect. Then you have bias, where the association is false, and then chance, where the association is false. Again, you have to all... and I have to say that we don't need to know heavy statistics to do clinical research, but we need to know statistics to discuss with a statistician. And more important, in the same way that we need a statistician to be in our midst to see how do we think as clinicians we need to know how a statistician thinks, because this is a totally different universe. They are living in a different universe, okay? And you cannot collaborate if one person is in one universe and the other is in a different one. And then, to throw another thing into the mix, they would say, well, I'm confused. I mean, this is what obesity has to do with mortality. Let me get some help. And the statistician is going to throw you a p-value, okay? They're going to get all this data, they're going to throw you a p-value. And for us, we may not know anything about the p-value, but we want a value that is very low. We want a 0.000. The more zeros, the better. We all agree with this. Then, I don't want to ask this question, but mentally, I ask you for you to answer mentally. You get the p-value. Then what is the meaning of a low p-value? A p-value is 0.0001. Because you get your study results. And you don't know if the study results is right or wrong, because we discussed. Then a low p-value, you may answer in your mind that the answer to a low p-value is A, because there is the probability of increased truth in the data, Maybe B, because there's a probability of less bias. Maybe C, because the probability of less confounding. D, probability of less chance. Or E, there's a significant probability that all of these things are happening with my data when I get a low p-value. Now, when I do this in our clinical research course that we do every year, when we do a clinical research course in other areas, when I get medical students and residents, I still have to see a group that get more than 50% the correct answer. Always more than 50% is the incorrect answer. That this is a problem for us, quote unquote, educators, because the only answer is chance. No, then a low p-value indicates that the possibility of chance in my results are decreased. Now I'm always concerned with the answer A or the answer E, because E include A. And then I'm always concerned with someone that is quote unquote in the scientific arena, assuming that in science we know the truth, and assuming that with some form of mathematical modeling we are going to get close to the truth. When this is what is truth is something that we are not going to get in this presentation, nor in anything doing clinical research, because truth is an elusive concept in science. Now, the point is, in statistics, statistical tests cannot be used to conclude that a hypothesis is probably true. A statistical test can be used essentially to conclude that a hypothesis is probably false. Now, you may say, well, if it's false, the other is true. No. You talk to a statistician, they never talk truth because they are scientists. Truth is out of the picture. And the only thing that they are going to tell you is that something is most likely false. Okay, then I have my question. Does this antibiotic decrease mortality? I have my hypothesis. My hypothesis is that, I read the literature, my hypothesis, this new antibiotic is going to decrease mortality in pneumonia. This is my hypothesis. This is what I want to prove. But then, statistics can only prove that a hypothesis is false. And then you read a little more, and you have this question of the rejection rule. Then the only thing is that, again, a hypothesis can never be accepted. A hypothesis can only be rejected. Then what do we do? Because I don't want to give my hypothesis to my statistician to be rejected. Then we come up with this confusing concept that, we need to come up with a new hypothesis to give to the statistician, someone that these guys can play around and can reject. But I don't want to give my hypothesis to them because I don't want my hypothesis to be rejected. Then we come up with the alternative hypothesis and the null hypothesis. The null hypothesis is the hypothesis that my antibiotic has nothing to do with mortality. Then this new antibiotic that I evaluated has that, or my question that obesity and mortality has nothing to do. It doesn't matter if you are undernourished, normal weight, overweight, obese, has nothing to do with the outcome of the patient with pneumonia. Then this will be the null hypothesis. Then essentially, now we're going to the null hypothesis is, again, there is no association between whatever is your predictor variable and your outcome variable. Then, this is the hypothesis that is rejected by the statistician when they have enough evidence to support that this hypothesis is probably false. And this enough evidence is coming when the p-value is less than 0.05. Then, if you reject this, then you can consider the alternative hypothesis. Just as a brief review, then your research hypothesis is the predictor variable, this antibiotic is going to decrease mortality. The null hypothesis, this new antibiotic is not associated with mortality. There's no relationship. The alternative hypothesis is that this antibiotic is associated with mortality. There is a relationship. I don't know if the new antibiotic is going to increase mortality or decrease mortality. I don't know the what direction. But the alternative hypothesis is telling me that there is an association. Then when the null hypothesis is rejected, we move to the alternative hypothesis. Then a small p-value indicates strong evidence against the null hypothesis, so it's rejected. Again, now, because this is rejected, doesn't mean that this is truth. Think, truth has nothing to do with what we're discussing. The only thing that we know, this is rejected. Another way to look at this, when you read about p-values, is that a p-value of 0.05 or 5%, then you have a 5% risk of a false positive result. If my antibiotic has nothing to do with mortality, and I reject the null hypothesis, I still have 5% possibility that I'm having the wrong, the 5% possibility chance explain the results. Then still this will be a false positive result, meaning that I consider that my hypothesis was not rejected, is valid, but in reality it's a false, you get a false positive result. Then this is the critical point after all this. It's a mistake to believe a research hypothesis just because the p-value is statistically significant. Then you can have a very, very significant p-value. And you may say, well, this result, the possibility of chance is low. What about confounding? What about bias? You may have a low p-value and the results could be completely wrong. Because the study is completely biased or you have a lot of confounders in the study. And this is just one piece, I may say a little piece of the equation. But at the end, we need to infer what happened with the conclusions into the universe. And then we are going to come up with our conclusions, and we're going to say this study suggests, this study indicates, this study we consider. But we will never say the truth is that this happened, because we don't know what is the truth. Then in this predictor variable, outcome variable, we are questioning the association is cause-effect. And then what are the techniques during this assessment period of your data? You're reviewing your study results. You're looking at your data. Then, of course, it's not just the p-value. There's a lot of other statistical analysis that you're going to work with a statistician or you're going to do yourself to evaluate the significance. Then there is a p-value, common things, not relative risk, the odds ratio, relative risk for prospective clinical trials or for cohort studies, odds ratio for case control studies. We're going to look at the confidence interval, the multivariate analysis, that there are different techniques for multivariate analysis. This is, we measure confounders in our data collection. And then the statistician is going to look at these confounders to see what is the, how much of this confounder is really alter the association. I'm sorry, I don't know what's happening with the microphone. Alter the association of the predictor variable with the outcome variable. Then when we say that, well, there's not a problem with confounders because the statistician is going to adjust for confounders. Well, the issue is that the statistician can adjust for any confounder that we measure. This is why the data collection form is so critical, because someone will need to look at your data collection form to be sure that you don't miss any confounder that you need to measure, because then this is what the statistician is going to be able to adjust. At the end of the day, we can only adjust for confounders that we know. We cannot adjust for the unknown confounders. And this is why in the pyramid of evidence, the prospective randomized trial is at the top, because randomization adjusts for confounders that we know and confounders that we don't know. And of course, the randomization is at the top of the pyramid to adjust for confounders, but to do this, as we mentioned, is a very expensive proposition. And then there is the clinical analysis. Some people stop with the statistical analysis. But when you read about this, we know that the clinical analysis is much more important than the statistical analysis. Some people even consider, first do the clinical analysis. If the clinical analysis is not there, why spending time in statistics? But the clinical analysis, then we look at the consistency with looking at other studies. What other studies are this particular predictor variable? The strength of the association is not just that it's significant, but no, the number needed to treat, the risk ratio, the biological plausibility. What is the pathophysiology that's going to explain how the predictor variable is associated with the outcome variable? But at the end of the day, is the usefulness, is the so what? Is the question of the so what of my results? I mean, how are we going to apply this into clinical practice? This is the most important evaluation of your data. How is that I can use this to improve patient care? And you have something that is very significant, but has zero application in patient care. I mean, who cares that you have a very low p-value? Now, you have a p-value that is 0.06. You say, oh, I didn't reach this 0.06. But the application in patient care will be tremendous. Who cares, this 5% or 6%? Who cares if you have 5% of a false positive versus 6% from the clinical point of view? It's because 5%, the statistician said 5% or less is significant, 5% or above is not significant. This means that I'm not going to use something because this is 5% possibility of false positive versus 6%. There's no difference. Then I remember the first studies of elevating the head of the bed in the patient in the ICU to prevent ventilator-associated pneumonia. And people were, remember that everybody was flat in the ICU 20 years ago. Now people say, let's elevate the head of the bed because we may prevent aspiration from the stomach. And the first studies, the p-value were, you know, they were not significant. But people say, well, who cares? I mean, it's just elevating the bed, just in case you may prevent ventilator-associated pneumonia. Let's do it. And we started doing this even before the P was significant. After that, you get enough patients, and now it became significant, and then you have one study, two studies, three studies. What is truth for you? How many studies do you need? Five? Forrest may want five. Anu may want 10. She's more skeptical. What is truth? I don't know. You just keep. But once you have 20 studies in different places, well, we say, well, you know what? This probably is the case. Because as scientists, the first study, what is your opinion? Oh, these guys don't know what they're doing. Oh, show me the bias. Oh, they confound it. This is always the case. But once you have 20 studies, some people say, well, you know, let's elevate the head of the bed to everybody, and this is now the standard of practice. But at the beginning, the P was not significant, but plenty of people didn't care. Then again, the clinical analysis is very important. Then this, of course, we add the statistical analysis, the clinical analysis, and we come up with a conclusion. We come up with a conclusion of our clinical research. Then disseminated study findings. Then we mentioned that we started with the idea, we finished with a publication, we write the study outline, write the protocol, we write the manual, we perform the study, analyze the data, we write the abstract, the poster, we write the article. Then what I try to say is that there's a lot of writing in clinical research. Then a lot of people say that you cannot do good clinical research unless you master medical writing. You just have to write, write, and write. Then this is critical. We cannot be running around all day long, and every time that we sit in front of the computer, there's something else to do. Or there's a new text message, or there's a new email. This attention deficit disorder is killing clinical research because it's killing writing. Okay. Then another thing is that writing is difficult. If it were simple, everybody would have 20 publications a year. Then you need to have a writing group. Again, this is a support group. I mean, it's been an alcoholic. You need a support group. Then you don't know how to write. You need a support group. We need a writing group. And your manuscript, you rewrite this version 1, version 2, version 7, version... and then one day, you submit. This always is going to be a rejection. Then you have to resubmit to the other journal. People say, oh, all these manuscripts are rejected. Well, I always say that once you write a manuscript that have version 20 and you finish, this is your baby, this is your manuscript, and everybody believes that your baby is beautiful. Then this is my baby, it's beautiful. This baby is ready for the New England Journal of Medicine. I would say, no, it's not going to be, no, I'm going to, okay, we you send it and you reject, and then finally your baby is going to be accepted someplace in the middle. Okay, then finally you get your publication. Then a clinical study is not completed until you get your publication in a peer-reviewed journal. This is why our review course that we do every day from idea to publication. Because without publication, you didn't finish your study. And this is why there are two statements for publication. One, investigators are measured by their publications. And really, you can be in any university all over the universe. It doesn't matter what you're doing. If you don't have publications, you're not going to get promoted. It doesn't matter what percentage you're doing or this or that. Publication has to be in your CV. And the other thing that is a challenge, and I challenge, is that without prior publication, there is no grant. Then, oh, I have this idea, I want to apply for this grant to study this or that. How much work have you done in this topic? How many publications do you have? No, this is my first, you're not going to get a grant. Nobody's going to give money to someone that doesn't have a record, that you've been doing this for some time. It's not going to happen. And this is the catch-22. If I cannot get funded unless I have at least 5 to 10 publications in the topic, how are you going to get my first publication? Well, this is why you are living in the university setting. And now we are moving into then my last section has to do with the challenges that we have in clinical research. And one of the big challenges I just put here is the clinical research infrastructure. Because you look at the literature, it's all over the place. People keep getting together every couple of months, this society, how can we improve clinical research in the United States? The answer is always the same, the problems. The problem is that we don't have enough mentors, there is not enough training program, there is not enough funding, and there is not enough infrastructure. And people keep getting together and keep getting also the same problems. Now, what are we doing in our universe of infectious diseases? Every member of the division is a mentor for clinical research, for studies on clinical research with our trainees or people that are with us in the division. We have one training program that is essentially what I've done now in these 40 minutes, is going to be the outline of our one-day training program. Imagine this expand to 8 hours, this is our one-day training program. We used to do a 7-day training program, but it was very difficult to find someone that attended the program. Then we concentrate all this in a Saturday from 8 to 5. And then we have a clinical research training program. It's an internship. We went through all the process at the University of Louisville. We get approved at every level to have our clinical research internship that we have some members here that is a one-year internship with us in the division. Minimal amount of funding. Well, funding, every division is supposed to have funding for research. This is why you do funded studies, you do studies with industry, you do all, and then it's supposed to be some money in your account that this money is going to do, you are going to use to generate new information, then it's going to be, you are going to use your own money. This is why you want to do clinical research, you need to attach to a group that is already doing clinical research, because they are going to be able to give you the support. And then inadequate infrastructure support, over the years, we've been developing our infrastructure support. When I started here, to talk to an statistician, I need to go to the School of Public Health. And it was very a difficult challenge to me. And finally, over the years, because we have funded, we're able to bring statisticians to the division, and we have data managers, then we develop our infrastructure for research. And just to finish, then this is a picture of how our infrastructure looks today. And we have different units. We have the Strategic Planning Administrative Unit with 4 members. That are the ones that if you are coming with an idea, because we support other members of the department, and we've been working probably with every division. You come to us, you are going to probably meet with one of these groups from the strategic planning. They coordinate all the other units. For our own research, we have a clinical research operational unit, and our Louisville clinical sites, as we know, are the 9 hospitals. We work in the 9 hospitals in Louisville plus clinics. Then our pneumonia study, we finish a group B streptococcal study. We are starting now with a Staph aureus bacteremic study. Everything applied to the 9 hospitals. We have a regulatory and financial unit with Kendra that is to be sure that everything is in order. our from the 150 members of the ID division, we have more or less 50 that are dedicated to clinical research. Then when you have 50 members doing clinical research, there's a lot of activities that happen in clinical research. Then we need to have 50 people that are approved in every hospital, that have approved in the IRB, that there's a lot of regulatory financial unit. There's a database with Kim that she's our expert in REDCap. There's a data quality unit with several members that as we mentioned, we do quality for all our studies. The statistical analysis unit, some of you may have worked before with Tim Winkham, that was our statistician for several years. Now Stephen is our lead statistician, and we just, he has several other members on the statistical team. A laboratory unit with Leslie Wolf, and Leslie is one of the faculty members that again, you may have remembered the name of Jim Summerskill, that was the director of our laboratory. Now, Dr. Wolf is the new director of our reference laboratory, but at the same time, is the director of the laboratory unit that we do a lot of laboratory research, but it's laboratory research applied to the things that we're doing in clinical research. For instance, they're just looking at they develop a PCR to look at the urine to define a gene for streptococcal pneumonia. Then they develop a PCR because we are interested in pneumonia. We know that the urine is a simple sample. We are looking at urine samples. Then it's laboratory research applied to our clinical research. Research informatics, Bill Mattingly, that again coming from the School of Engineering, and he's very much into informatics. And there's a lot of things that I presented in our research studies that were developed with this unit. The information technology unit, Chris, because when you, from the 150 members of the ID division, probably 100 or more were in the Med Center 1. Then we're in the neighborhood, but we are far away. It's almost 3-4 blocks from here. And when we have 50 people doing clinical research connected to every hospital, making sure that everything works, whenever we have a problem with a computer, we cannot put a ticket to the university and figure out in 4 or 5 days when we are going to reconnect to Baptist Hospital. This needs to happen now. Then we have our own information technology in Med Center 1. To be sure that computer issues get resolved right there. We have a biorepository unit, and Subic is, again, a biorepository unit. We don't have a biorepository as our colleagues from cancer have, that is a massive biorepository, but we have more than 10,000 samples in our biorepository. With all the implications, we are working with different universities, we submit samples. You need to have a database to manage your biorepository. And finally, Emily, that is in charge of our personnel management unit, that again, to maintain everything in order and salaries and overtime, but also we have a lot of foreign medical graduates, and we work a lot with the international unit to have all these visas in order to be sure that everything is in the proper order. Then this is more or less the idea of our clinical research coordinator center that support the research in the division, and again, for the last years, probably support plenty of your clinical studies for several of the members of the department. And essentially, I discussed a little bit of the definition. I want to emphasize to the students, to the residents, that this is why you need universities. This is why you need all forms of research, from laboratory research to animal research to clinical research, because this is where the new knowledge is generated. If the medical students, 5 years down the road or 10 years down the road, are going to learn something different, it's because you guys doing research in a university setting generated the new knowledge that's going to advance patient care. Without clinical research, there is no advancement. There is no new knowledge. Then this is a critical part. Now, another thing is that you go now, see your patient with pneumonia, and you treat the patient, you are doing patient care of one patient. You do a study of pneumonia, and you come out with a new intervention for pneumonia, and you are treating every pneumonia patient all over the universe. Then we are doing research to generate new methods to improve patient care. This is why it's so critical. And why university? Because, You need a village. You need a village to do everything that we do, but you need definitely a team to do clinical research. It's impossible to do it alone. I went through planning, performing the study, analyzing the study results, disseminating the study finding, the research finished because if we do all our study and we found that this intervention worked and I don't publish, it's not research, because I'm doing research for the patients in the universe. If this intervention, no, I need to publish for the guy in China, in Chile, in South Africa, be able to use it. Otherwise, I'm not doing research for my patients. I do research for the patients in the universe. Without publication, there's no research. How the other people are going to know? And finally, our efforts to put together a clinical research infrastructure that, again, is available to anyone in the Department of Medicine that wants to get involved in some clinical research activities. Thank you very much.
I think it's pretty obvious that Hudo's done a spectacular job, really, of building up a really nice clinical research empire. I have one little comment. Okay, I am a basic science researcher, and I saw that basic science research falls under the low quality research. I mean, I would prefer to think of that as maybe preclinical, you know, not low quality, because I hope everything I've done hasn't been low quality. Let me ask.
No. Let me clarify. It doesn't say low quality. It says low evidence. Because, you know, and it's not me, it's the people that are evidence-based medicine. The evidence-based medicine, then what is the research that you're doing, how much of this research you can apply to patient care, and what is the evidence? Now, it's interesting. We do a lot of things in patient based on laboratory research. I can tell you that we're just discussing this. There are patients with multi-resistant organisms that they are resistant to everything. We go to microbiology and say, let's test this new thing against this bacteria. In the tube seems to be that something happened. We go from laboratory research all the way to the patient. This is very low evidence, extremely low evidence. This can change, but I don't have a clinical, I don't have case reports, I don't have cohort, I don't have clinical trials. But we need to understand that the evidence that I'm using from the laboratory is still low evidence. It can change as it moves through the process.
So can you comment on where point of care research fits into this?
Yeah, I may say that there is, when you say point of care research, doing research as we, because they are, this is a small characteristic of the definition of research, cohort studies and. This point of care, this something is called now pragmatic research. There is the idea of doing research with everyday patients, doing research as happened in real life. This is one of the big negatives of clinical trials. Because people, it's another thing. Why most of what we do is coming from cohort studies? A clinical trial, the prospective randomized clinical trial, every time that you look at a clinical trial, you figure out how many exclusion criteria the clinical trial have. At least 30. Because, again, I want to just criticize clinical trials to fit the point. Because we are testing a new antibiotic. We are testing any new intervention. The idea of the clinical trial is to get this intervention approved by the regulatory agency. It's a new antibiotic for pneumonia. Okay. It's a new vaccine to prevent pneumonia. And I need to approve this vaccine. Then what do? I want to give a study of the vaccine for patients with pneumonia. Okay, this patient has cancer. No, I don't want a cancer patient because I don't know the immune response, may not respond. This patient has, no, I don't want it. Let me get the perfect patient to test this drug to see if the perfect patient improve. Nothing wrong, but this is the clinical trial. I have this new antibiotic. Oh, the patient is in intensive care unit. No, it's excluded. Intensive care unit is too severe for a new antibiotic. I want the patient on the ward, and then the antibiotic get approved. But clinical trials never approve things for real-life patients. Clinical trials are always the ideal patient. This is the problem of clinical trials. This is why then you need to go back. This is the idea of, I'm testing this new antibiotic. What is the efficacy? Efficacy is, does the drug work in the ideal situation? Effectiveness, does the drug work in real life? And for real life, go back to, we need to do real life studies. We need to go back to studies with real patients. This is the problem of clinical trials. This is why there is so much of what we do in practice is based on observational studies, because these are real life studies.
I just want to thank you for a very thorough and organized talk, and I think hopefully there's enough young people out there, maybe a few old people like myself, that will use this to stimulate them to start something. I think it's a good, stimulating, thorough way to get new people involved.
Yes, thank you. Yes, this is one of the primary goals. Yes.
Okay.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
That's great.